Hello, and welcome to the Evelyn Y. Davis Studios at the National Press Foundation. Today we're talking with an extraordinary journalist, Linda Deutsch, for our Masterclass series.
The National Press Foundation is a nonprofit dedicated to helping journalists cover complex topics with depth and accuracy. Our mission includes journalists around the U.S. and around the world.
I'm Sandy Johnson, president of the National Press Foundation. With me today is Linda Deutsch, special correspondent and legal reporter for the Associated Press. Linda recently retired and has been honored with the Lifetime Achievement Award from the International Women's Media Foundation. So, Linda, how did Elvis Presley jumpstart your career in journalism?
It's a very interesting story, and it's true that that did jumpstart my career. I became president of one of the first Elvis fan clubs in the country. I was enchanted with him the first time I heard him. And I started thinking it would be great to have a newspaper about Elvis. And so I started one. And my father had given me a typewriter when I was 12 years old. And he had a mimeograph machine down in the basement in those days, because he was involved in clubs. And I started publishing this newspaper. I would communicate with Elvis headquarters in Memphis. I had 300 members all over the world. I mailed them out. I had my own news service. It was really prophetic what I would be doing later.
Mm-hmm. And you got one of your first breaks while you were still in college when you came down to Washington. Can you tell us about that?
Yes. Uh-huh. I had known pretty early on that I would be a journalist. I had an uncle who was a journalist, who was a newspaper editor, and he pointed me in that direction since I was a writer. And I went the second semester, I was a sophomore in college. My journalism professor got me a job for the summer at a paper in Perth Amboy, New Jersey. And I worked nights. I never saw anyone. I was there from 7 at night till 3 in the morning. But I had time to read the paper. And I saw a little article about how there was going to be this civil rights march on Washington. It was 1963. Mm-hmm. And I was all of 18 years old, but I clipped this out. I left the clipping on the editor's desk when I went home that night and said, "Don't you think we should cover this?" And the next day he called me at home and he said, "So you want to cover this, huh?" And I said, "Oh, yes, I would really love to." And he said, "Well, you can cover it, but it can't cost us anything." And so I got my first lesson in journalistic economics. And I thought, okay. And I called the NAACP chapter and asked if I could go with them on their bus. And they were thrilled to have me. And so I rode with them and got stories on the bus. And then I got there and I heard Martin Luther King give his famous I Have a Dream speech. And I linked arms with a lot of the other people and sang We Shall Overcome. And it was a life-altering moment, because that night I came back, wrote my story, and it was my first front page byline.
Mm-hmm. And do you remember what you wrote?
Oh, yes, I've seen the story. In fact, I found it. The year before was the 50th anniversary. And so our archivist went and found the story. Mm-hmm. And I wrote that it was one of the most significant events of the Civil Rights Movement.
You got the lead right the first time.
I did, and I was worried about it. When I went back and looked at it, you know how you wonder, at 18, did I write it the way it should have been? I did.
That's great. So tell us about your migration westward and how you got into trial reporting.
Okay. I had graduated from Monmouth University in New Jersey, and there were no jobs around then in New York. And my uncle, who was editor of a newspaper by then in California, suggested I come west. I came to visit, took a look around, saw the Hollywood sign, and thought, this is where I want to be. I was dazzled. So I went back, earned a little money so I could, I was working at the local paper, and when I had $1,000, I thought that was enough. And that paid for a plane ticket west, paid for a down payment on my little red VW bug, and for a down payment on an apartment. And I moved to California. I worked briefly at a paper in San Bernardino, and then I went and interviewed in L.A., and the AP hired me on the spot because I already had quite a bit of experience and clips. Timing was so much a part of my career because I came to L.A. in 1967. That's when the AP hired me. In 68, Bobby Kennedy was killed in Los Angeles, and I was in the office and worked on the assassination and was a backup reporter on the Sirhan trial. But the big thing that really dictated my path in journalism happened in 1969 when Sharon Tate and her friends were murdered in Los Angeles, the biggest murder case ever. And the arrest of the Manson family sent it skyrocketing. Mm-hmm. It was a huge story, and I was assigned to it from day one.
Tell us a little bit about Manson and his followers. What was unique about them?
Manson was an ex-con who came out of prison right at the height of the Haight-Ashbury Flower Power movement, and he was released into San Francisco. And as the story goes, he was walking down a street, a girl handed him a flower and said, "Love." And he thought, wow, something's going on here that I didn't know about. And he began to collect young women. And he got himself a bus, and he took everybody down to Southern California, started this cult. He told them he was Jesus incarnate. He knew everything. He preached the crazy kind of ersatz philosophy. He was the first big cult leader in the United States. Mm-hmm. There would be many after him. There would be Jim Jones. There would be David Koresh. But Manson was the first. And he managed to get in with some of the music stars in L.A. He had a dream that he was going to be a music star. He was going to be a singer. He really wasn't very good. He wrote some music. It wasn't up to snuff, but the Beach Boys, among others, took a look at him. For a while, he and his acolytes moved in with Dennis Wilson. But it wasn't working, and so he finally got them into a ranch out in the San Fernando Valley, the Spawn Ranch, and they lived there. And he had not that many people, really, maybe 30, but they were all very young. That was his talent, mm-hmm. was picking these very young, impressionable kids who would think that he was so smart. And he was very charismatic, spoke a good line, and so they lived on garbage. They used to go and pick through the remains at grocery stores at night, things they threw out. Mm-hmm. And at some point, when he couldn't get started in the music business, he decided to exercise the ultimate power and kill people.
And tell us about the crime scene, because that's one of the most vivid memories of my early years. It was just extraordinary.
Yeah. The house up in, it was near Bel Air. It was actually on the line between Los Angeles and Bel Air. The scene that was discovered on the morning of August 9th, 1969, a day that will live forever, was horrific. It was blood everywhere. It was bodies everywhere. There were five people killed up there. One of them being Sharon Tate, the gorgeous wife of Roman Polanski, the film director, and her friends, Abigail Folger, who was the heir to the Folger coffee fortune. There was a Polish film director, Wojciech Frykowski. There was Jay Sebring, who was then the celebrity hairdresser to the stars. All of them were found strewn around the estate, stabbed or shot, mostly stabbed. There was blood scrawled on the walls, words like pigs and rise. And a young man who had been visiting the caretaker was also killed. So it was a horrific scene. And the housekeeper discovered it and came running, screaming out of the house, screaming, "There's blood and bodies everywhere." That day, I was out in Orange County, assigned to meet the plane of President Nixon, who was coming in to look at his new home, his Western White House in San Clemente. And I had the what they call touchdown duty. You go to the airport, you make sure the president's plane landed and call it in. And then the White House press corps takes over. And I called in and they said, forget about the president. There's a huge story that's much bigger. You got to get in here quickly. And I raced into Los Angeles to the bureau. And I worked around the clock at that point.
Mm-hmm. And how did they tie Manson and his followers to the killings?
It took a long time. There was another set of killings first that night. The LaBiancas were killed in the Los Feliz area. People thought maybe it was a copycat killing. Maybe there were other killers. They never thought it was the same ones, but it was. Mm-hmm. One of the Manson followers, a young woman, was arrested in a break-in at a store. And while she was in the women's prison, she got the urge to talk. And she talked to a cellmate. And that's what broke the case. She told her she was part of that famous, you know, now infamous set of killings, and told her all the details. And the other prisoner saw a way to get out of jail and went to her lawyer and told him. Mm-hmm. And so they quickly let word be known that this was at least one of the women. Then they had to track down the other members of this cult. And they finally did track down Manson up in the high desert in another kind of remote ranch area. And when they came into the bathroom at the place, he was so little that he was stuffed into a cabinet under the sink. And they said he looked out and he said, oh, hello. And they arrested him. Mm-hmm. But they arrested him for something totally different. They weren't sure yet what was going on. They arrested him for stealing motorcycles. Mm-hmm. When they finally got everyone back into L.A. and started questioning them, they realized they had the killers.
Mm-hmm. And the trial was a bit of a circus.
The trial mm-hmm. was like nothing that ever was or ever hopefully will be again. It was insanity. The Manson followers decided to camp outside the courthouse. They lived there on the sidewalk, most of them young, beautiful girls, mm-hmm. In their outfits that they had made out at the, they wore all these hippie type clothes, and they were willing to tell anyone that would listen that Charlie was innocent and that he was going to be acquitted, and that if he wasn't, they were going to immolate themselves in the way that the nuns had been doing in Vietnam. Mm-hmm. And we were worried the whole time that they might do it. In the courtroom, there were people having LSD flashbacks. There were strange people that showed up that had nothing to do with it, but were drawn by this crazy story. The Manson women would jump up and down the courtroom singing at his instruction. At one point, Manson himself, who was very small, propelled himself across the counsel table at the judge with a pencil in his hand, screaming, "Someone should cut your head off, old man." It was not your usual trial. And for most of the trial, the defendants weren't even in the courtroom because they were misbehaving so much that they took them to an adjacent room to listen on an audio feed. It was, the lawyers were bizarre. Manson had sent word that he wanted the worst lawyer in Los Angeles, and he got him, Irving Kanarek, who really wasn't up to this at all. He gave a final argument that lasted for 2 weeks, and at the end he read the Bible because he said Manson was Jesus being persecuted, and he read the whole Easter service until the judge cut him off at the Ascension.
And Manson is still in prison, correct?
He uh-huh. is. Mm-hmm. He is. Mm-hmm. He doesn't want to get out. He says prison is his home.
And let's fast forward a little bit to football hero O.J. Simpson. His trial raised issues of race that still resonate today.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And how did that unfold?
Some accused his lawyers of playing the race card. The trial of O.J. Simpson in a very different era became almost bigger than Manson. Even though Manson was more colorful in many ways, it wasn't on television. And that was the difference. Mm-hmm. The judge in the O.J. Simpson case, Judge Lance Ito, decided to allow gavel-to-gavel coverage on TV. And it was the first time that the public had been able to see an entire trial beginning to end every day. And it went on for a year. Mm-hmm. And so it became part of the regular programming. And people changed their work schedule so they could be home to watch it. And it was huge. O.J. Simpson was a very famous man. He was the most famous American ever charged with murder. And the murder was of his gorgeous ex-wife, Nicole, and a young man who she had known, who came to the house that night just by accident to drop off a pair of eyeglasses that had been left at the restaurant where he worked. There was, again, a very bloody scene found. It was a shocking crime. And more shocking was when they named O.J. Simpson as a suspect. You have to understand that this was a man who was a football hero, a movie star, a sports commentator, mm-hmm. a pitch man for Hertz. Mm-hmm. He had everything. He truly transcended race. Everybody loved O.J. And even if you weren't a sports fan, you knew him. And he had a beautiful smile and a charismatic personality, and he was Mr. America in many ways. Mm-hmm. And now here he's charged with these horrendous crimes. And the day that the police went to arrest him, he left in a white Bronco with his friend Al Cowlings at the wheel driving, and helicopters following them overhead, the police following them from behind, and what became known as the slow speed chase. Mm-hmm. And one detective was talking to him on the phone. It sounded like he was planning to kill himself. And he had left a letter that sounded very much like a suicide note. But he didn't kill himself. I was not in L.A. that day. I had just finished a series of trials, and my bureau chief said, take a vacation. You've been through so much already. And I was in New Jersey visiting friends when I heard about O.J. Simpson and the chase and everything else. And I rushed to the phone, called my editor in Los Angeles, and I said, every lawyer I know is getting involved in this. I could see them on television. I said, do you want me to fly back? And he was very smart. He said to me, you know, if he kills himself, the story will be over very quickly. And if he doesn't, you're going to be covering this for a very long time. So why don't you finish your vacation? And I did, but, you know, most of the time I was watching what was going on in L.A. I got back in time for his major arraignment. And from then on, I was covering that for more than a year. So he was right.
Mm-hmm. And how did the trial unfold?
The trial was, it belonged to the defense. O.J. Simpson was a wealthy man. He was able to hire some of the finest lawyers, not just in L.A., but in the country. Mm-hmm. Johnny Cochran was the star of L.A. law. He was brilliant. He was charismatic. He could take over a courtroom like a preacher takes over a church. He was such a personality and brilliant, absolutely brilliant. And he had him. He had Robert Shapiro, who was very well known in the Los Angeles legal community. He brought in people like Alan Dershowitz from Harvard. He brought in Barry Scheck, who was then the emerging expert in DNA, which was brand new, mm-hmm. just had become. And so the case became partially a big forensic exploration of evidence. They had to, you know, analyze the blood and where the blood was found and whether whose it was and so forth. But the deciding factor for the prosecution really was who they chose as the lead witness, who was a detective, a police detective, who had investigated the case. He was the first one on the scene. His name was Mark Furman, and he wound up being a lightning rod. He wound up being tried for perjury after the trial. And the defense, in a stroke of luck, really, was contacted by a woman who had interviewed Mark Furman for a book and had tapes of him and the tapes were filled with expletives about black people. Mm-hmm. How much of a racist he was became evident. Mm-hmm. And so the defense had a good argument that this was a racial case, that prejudice was behind it, that that's why they went after O.J. Simpson. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And they were able to get... a lot of people think that the whole jury was black. They were not. It was a mixed jury. And actually, the first jury that was sworn in the case did not decide it because mm-hmm. it went on for so long that they kept losing jurors and they had to put in alternates. So at the end, the final jury was mostly alternates mm-hmm. and they were both black and white.
Mm-hmm. And the final result was...
O.J. Simpson was acquitted, mm-hmm. and to the public, it was a huge murder mystery. Nobody quite knew what was going to happen at the end. Mm-hmm. I kind of had a clue. In fact, during the final days when the jury was going to be going out, the prosecutor, Marcia Clark, came to my office, and she said to me, "Do you think we even have a chance?" It was that obvious mm-hmm. that it was being lost, mm-hmm. because... they had not been able to prove him guilty. The forensic evidence, a lot of it was messed up. It had not been handled well. Just to give you an example, one of the investigators carried around a vial with O.J. Simpson's blood in it that day that was taken at the police station, put it in his pocket, and walked around with it all day, including going to visit O.J.'s house. And lo and behold, there were droplets of blood going up the front walk, where O.J. hadn't even walked mm-hmm. during that night. Mm-hmm. And so there was an indication maybe he, you know, salted the scene. There were a lot of bits and pieces of evidence. There was a video taken by the police of O.J.'s bedroom, and there was nothing on the carpet. They take a video about an hour later, and suddenly there are bloody socks. Mm-hmm. How'd they get there? Nobody knew. It was that kind of thing. So they were putting together all these pieces of evidence. Mm-hmm. And although the family testified very heartrendingly that O.J. and Nicole had not had a happy marriage, that they had had domestic violence, that the family thought he might kill her someday, it was not enough. Mm-hmm. And he did not testify in the trial, but he was able to testify through his personality, just his facial expressions. He was an actor. And, you know, if they showed the pictures of the bloody crime scene, he turned away. Then there was the most dramatic moment of the trial when... one of the prosecutors, Chris Darden, for whatever reason, I think he was kind of goaded into it, asked O.J. to try on the bloody murder gloves, which had been found, one at his house, one at Nicole's house. And there was a lot of suggestion that they had been planted. And O.J. got up and put on these very light plastic gloves, because they were evidence, and put on the gloves, and they didn't fit. They were way too small. And he walked over to the jury and held them up and said, "They don't fit." And sitting next to me in the courtroom was the great columnist Dominic Dunn, who really didn't like O.J. and thought he should be convicted and everything else. But he turned to me and he said, "Did you see what he did? He took those gloves and he ran like he was running down a football field. This case is over." And he was right.
And before we leave the trial behind, the Kardashian family had a cameo long before the Kardashians became a reality show.
Right.
And that was through Robert Kardashian.
Right.
And what role did he play?
Robert Kardashian was a lawyer who was a friend, very close friend of O.J.'s for many years. The family socialized together and were members of the same country club and all of that. When O.J. was arrested, Kardashian, who had not practiced law for many years, renewed his license and decided to be there for his friend. And he pretty much kept O.J.'s spirits up. He would go and sit with him in the jail cell. Simpson was in custody through the whole trial. And so he did that, and he, you know, did what he could for the defense. After the trial was over, O.J. Simpson called me to thank me for being fair to him, because the trial produced a very polarized press corps. A lot of people were convinced he was guilty. Some were equally convinced he was innocent. I took no position. As an AP reporter, I wouldn't. But I really was so confused by all this evidence that to this day, I don't know if he did it or not. I really don't. It's not my job. Not my job to decide if a defendant did it. But I do have to telegraph to an audience whether they proved that he did it. You know, in England, they have a verdict which is proven or not proven, which is really more to the point of what the justice system is about. I felt they it was not proven. And so when O.J. called me and thanked me, we began a conversation that went on for years. Anytime he had anything to say, he'd call me, or if I had something to ask him about, I'd call him. I visited him a couple of times up at his Rockingham estate. On the 10th anniversary, I went down to Florida and interviewed him there. We had a continuing rapport, if you might call it, in which I felt he was always straight with me, and he knew that I wasn't going to burn him. He once said in an interview with editor and publisher, when they asked him why he talked to me so much, he said, "You know, she never said she thought I didn't do it, but she never said she thought I did it either. And that's why I talked to her."
And that's why you have the reputation you do.
Right.
Yeah. Before we leave that behind, I remember watching the trial, and at during the proceedings, Linda Deutsch would come out and brief the other reporters on what was going on. Can you describe how the concept of a pool reporter evolved in trial reporting?
Well, I think it evolved initially with the White House in this country. The president was always surrounded by press, and when the president would go out on trips or out on the road, they couldn't take everybody. So there was always a pool of reporters selected by their, usually by their colleagues, to go and watch and take notes and come back and tell the other reporters what had happened. I had seen that at the Western White House. I had even participated in it. It was not televised. It was just in the press room. But the Simpson trial was going to be such a sensation, and so many people wanted in. For jury selection, the judge found that there was not enough room in the courtroom for everybody that wanted to be in there, because the courtroom was filled with prospective jurors. So he contacted me. He knew me from, I was around the courthouse all the time, and this was well into my career. And he called me in, and he asked if I would be the pool reporter. And I was. At times, some others would join me if there was room. They'd have maybe someone from the LA Times, some TV person. But the TV people were happy to have me because I did not have allegiance to any station. I was not theirs. So everybody could use me on the air. And they did. And what happened was that every time there was a break in the proceedings, they would rush me down to the lobby to the cameras, and I would give a quick report. So four or five times a day, I was talking to 40 million people. It was overwhelming, because up until then, I had been a known byline, but I had not been a known face. And I now became the face of the trial in many ways. I mean, I couldn't go anywhere without somebody stopping me on the street and saying, "How's it going? How's that trial coming along?"
Let's talk about Rodney King. There was an early instance of amateur video prompting prosecution. He was just a motorist who was pulled aside, and then what happened?
Well, it was an incredible development at that time, because people didn't all have video cameras. It was an oddity if you had one. It was a toy, kind of. And this man who happened to be having one and was out on his balcony of his apartment saw something going on. And what it was the police were beating up a motorist. And the citizen, George Holliday, got his camera and started shooting and didn't stop. And as a result, you had a a video that he sold that night to a TV station. And it showed a horrendous beating, really just unbelievable, tasing, beating, kicking him in the head. It was painful to watch. And there were several police officers, and King was a big man, but he did not appear to be resisting in any way.
And they pulled him over for?
Traffic infraction.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And that led to a violent beating.
Mm-hmm. And he was taken to the hospital. And once the video got out, there was really outrage in the city. Mm-hmm. And the policemen were indicted.
Mm-hmm.
And charged with using excessive force. Mm-hmm. And I covered the trial, which was so controversial that they actually got a change of venue from L.A., which is almost never done because it's such a huge city, you can usually get enough jurors to take care of any trial.
Mm-hmm.
But this one was moved to Simi Valley, which was north of Los Angeles, and was in a bedroom community for police officers. It also was in a brand new courthouse that had no other courtrooms. It was like trying it in a cocoon. And the video must have been shown. I think I've seen that video maybe 100 times. It was painful every time. I couldn't watch it without flinching. And there were lots of witnesses. There was a prosecutor who was dedicated to the case. And at some point, things turned, and I will never know really why, but they were acquitted.
Mm-hmm.
And when we walked into that courtroom for the verdict, and we kind of sensed that was what was going on, the reporter next to me turned to me and she said, you know, when this comes in, if they're acquitted, we can then go cover the riots.
And
within, I had dictated my story before it was on, as it was moving on the wire, the riots had broken out in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm.
And that case almost destroyed my city. It almost destroyed my belief in the justice system because it was the wrong verdict. There was no question it was the wrong verdict.
Mm-hmm.
And I later was able to track down a juror who told me how she was browbeaten into going along with that verdict by her fellow jurors. It was horrible, and there was millions of dollars of damage to L.A. People were killed. A trucker by the name of Reginald Denny was beaten to a pulp in front of cameras. Again, the cameras played such a role in this case. And later, the people that beat him went on trial. It was horrific. And I had always thought that the courtroom was a place where you could bring resolution to any conflict. Peacefully, that, you know, if there was a murder, you brought in the person charged, either he was convicted or acquitted, and it was all done peacefully, but not this one.
Mm-hmm.
This one just, it engendered more violence than the initial crime.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And everyone tried to make up for it. Afterwards, there was a federal trial, a federal civil rights violation trial, and some of the policemen were convicted and did go to prison.
Mm-hmm.
But it was too late. Mm-hmm. You know, by then the damage had been done. A huge commission was brought in to investigate this whole situation with the police, because the police were out of control.
Mm-hmm.
And the commission came up with new rules, and they were under a federal edict for a long time to clean up their act, mm-hmm. basically. And they did. And then there was a third Rodney King trial. For a couple of years, that's all I was covering. Because the third one, I'm quoted in a book as addressing the press corps and saying, welcome to the annual Rodney King trial. This was when he sued for damages.
Mm-hmm.
And again, it was in federal court and he won.
Mm-hmm.
And he testified, he turned out to be a very intelligent, gentle man who just had big drug problems in his life.
Mm-hmm.
And he eventually died of, I think, a drug overdose, but or, you know, physical problems resulting from his drug use.
Mm-hmm. Still a scenario that we see being played out over and over again in recent years with with alleged police brutality. Yeah.
But he did get some money.
Yeah. Let's move to another case. A young, beautiful heiress, Patty Hearst, was kidnapped. And then what happened?
That was, at that time, that was 1974. And it was called by a lot of people the trial of the century. Because she was the heiress to a newspaper fortune, the Hearst family. Mm-hmm. And a revolutionary group called the Symbionese Liberation Army, which was kind of a post-Vietnam young people, alienated people, trying to avenge something. We were never quite sure what. They kidnapped her from her home, took her hostage, and she, within 24 hours or so, she was on television. She had made a video with her captors. She was wearing a beret, like a military beret. She had a gun. And she was saying that she had taken the name Tanya, and she was now joining her captors. She thought they were going in the right direction, and she was going to work with them. It was shocking. She denounced her parents as ageist, sexist pigs. And she became hunted just as her captors were. I have a copy of the FBI wanted poster, which has Patricia Hearst as one of the wanted. And during the time that she was with them, she robbed a bank in San Francisco, the Hibernia Bank. Her best friend in her privileged life before that was the daughter of the president of the bank. Mm-hmm. That was the ultimate irony. Mm-hmm. So she was missing for 18 months. And during that time, I was assigned to find her. So were a lot of other reporters. And I went all over the country. And I did come close to finding her. She was in Pennsylvania at one point, and so was I. I'm kind of glad I didn't find her because I might not be sitting here talking mm-hmm. to you. It was probably the most dangerous assignment I ever had. I spent pretty much a year looking for her, didn't find her. And then I was summoned to Sacramento because one of the Manson women, bringing things full circle, mm-hmm. had aimed a gun at President Ford mm-hmm. in a park up there. And they knew that I knew her. I had to fly from Pennsylvania to Sacramento, covered that story, and I was waiting to interview the Manson woman, Squeaky Frome, in prison when we got word that Patty Hearst had been captured in San Francisco. Mm-hmm. And I jumped into my rental car with my dear friend, Theo Wilson, who was the famous reporter for the New York Daily News. And we raced into San Francisco with Theo riding backwards looking for cops because we were going so fast. And we got there in time for the arraignment. And then I was covering Patty Hearst for the next year.
Mm-hmm. And the outcome of that trial?
She was convicted mm-hmm. of armed bank robbery. Mm-hmm. She may have been the worst witness I ever saw for her own cause. Her lawyer, Effie Bailey, had her take the Fifth Amendment like 46 times. It's not good. Mm-hmm. And she had done it. I mean, they had her on tape holding up this rifle at the scene of the crime. What we learned later was that the reason for the way that her defense went was that her lawyer was terrified that they were going to connect her to another crime in Sacramento, which was another bank robbery in which a woman was killed. Mm. She indeed turned out to be the getaway driver in that one. But nobody knew that during her trial, or she could have been charged with murder. Mm-hmm. And he didn't want her to testify about anything other than to let the jury see her. And she did some things that were, they made people think she was lying. Mm-hmm. For instance, she had joined her captors. There was no question about that, although the defense claimed she hadn't. They had doctors testify and so forth about the Stockholm syndrome.
Brainwashing.
Yeah, right. Brainwashing. Mm-hmm. But there had been a story written that said that she had been romantically involved with one of the captors, a boy by the name of Willie Wolf from Pennsylvania. And that when they pledged their love to each other, he gave her a little trinket. It was called an Olmec monkey. It was from Mexico, and she was interested in archaeology or whatever. He gave her this, and he had the twin of it. And they wore them, or carried them with them. The prosecutor, reading this article, suddenly thought, wow, that's interesting. And he went back to the evidence locker and got out the purse that was taken from Patty when she was arrested. And in there was the little Olmec monkey. Mm. The twin of it was found under Willie Wolf's body in the remains of the house that was burned in Los Angeles with the SLA people in it. And he got up and he said to the jury, how many women carry... She claimed that Willie Wolf had raped her when mm-hmm. she testified. And he said, how many women carry the souvenir of a rapist in their purse?
One more case. Michael Jackson, very mm-hmm. popular singer, was charged with sexual molestation.
Right. That case was almost bigger than anything else I ever did. There were 2,000 reporters credentialed for that case. Luckily, they were not all there at the same time, or they wouldn't have been able to operate, but there were a lot of them there. And it was in Santa Maria, California, which was 150 miles north of Los Angeles. And the town had never seen anything like this. They moved it there from Santa Barbara, which had been the original venue. Mm-hmm. It was a tiny courthouse, and it was near Michael's home at Neverland, his incredible estate. And that's why it was held there. He should have never been charged, as it turned out, because the charges were made by a woman who was weird. And also, she was a scam artist. She had already done things like filed claims against JCPenney, claiming that she was hurt in their store or her children were hurt. She was always using her children to get money. Mm-hmm. And she had somehow inveigled herself into Michael Jackson's life. She had a son who was sick, and Michael was a great supporter of children's charities and hospitals. And so he let her come with the boy to stay at Neverland to recover. He gave them the Elizabeth Taylor suite, a cabin out on the property that had swans in a lake in front of it. It was idyllic. She obviously wanted to stay there forever. And he told her she couldn't. And when he did and evicted them, she sued and claimed he had molested her children. She was one of the strangest witnesses I've ever seen. She turned to the jury all the time and snapped her fingers at them and said, listen to me, this happened. Had I ever seen her and I was a prosecutor, I would have never brought this case. He also wound up with one of the greatest lawyers in Los Angeles, Tom Mesereau, who had never really gotten a lot of press attention. But Michael wanted the best, and he had a kind of a falling out with Mark Garagus, who was his main lawyer, because Garagus was about to represent Scott Peterson, and he was going back and forth and not giving his full attention, Michael thought. And Mesereau was the perfect lawyer for the case, and cared a lot about Michael. I still see him frequently, and he still grieves for Michael because he feels that the trial destroyed him. Mm-hmm. He was so upset by it and so wounded that people would think this of him. Mm-hmm. And there are people that still believe he was a molester.
Well, let's talk about the outcome of the trial.
Yeah. So after 5 months of testimony and a lot of videos and friends coming to testify and so forth, Jay Leno testified in that case, believe it or not, Michael was acquitted. Mm-hmm. And It was an amazing day, and the prosecutors immediately had a press conference. And I went to the press conference, and I said to the prosecutor, who had been pursuing Michael forever, it was like he was like Javert to Jean Valjean. He had tried to get him on the same charges years before. And I said to him, his name was Tom Snedden, I said, "Tom, are you through chasing Michael Jackson?" And he paused for just a second and said, "No comment." And that night, Michael Jackson left Neverland and never came back.
That was another case where didn't he call you or didn't you talk to him on
yes.
the telephone?
Uh-huh. Michael took refuge in the Middle East. He went to Bahrain and was staying with a prince there who was interested in music. And he called me to thank me again for being fair. Mm-hmm. That press corps was so weighted against him that I really had no one to talk to in that case. I had like two or three friends from LA who were up there from NBC and from the local paper who were willing to be objective. But most of the people that came were gossip, tabloid people, some magazines, and they all were there with the obvious determination to get Michael Jackson. This mm-hmm. was when they were going to get him. Mm-hmm. I don't know why they wanted to get him. He was a very sweet guy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He was always very nice to me. He didn't talk much during the trial, but if he did, they put me outside as the, again, the pool kind of, and said, "You ask him the question, he seems to respond." And I would ask him mundane things like, "How are you feeling today? Did you, you know, are you fighting a cold or whatever?" He mm-hmm. had some health problems during the trial.
Mm-hmm.
And he would answer briefly. But when he called me, I said to him, "You know, what was the trial like for you?" And he said, "It was the hardest thing I've ever done in my life."
And you alluded to celebrity journalism a little bit ago. How has that changed trials and trial coverage over the years?
It has changed it. During, as late as the O.J. Simpson trial, there was no 24-hour tabloid news cycle.
Mm-hmm.
The only things that were existing on TV that covered trials were CNN and Court TV, which no longer exists.
Mm-hmm.
And once the tabloid TV came in, then it was, they had such a huge news hole to fill that it was, you know, 24 hours a day. And it also became a place for opinions. Every show had talking heads, people who would come in, lawyers, ex-judges even were participating. And they would give their opinion of what had happened in the courtroom. And reporters who were doing trials also were called upon to have opinions. And that was when I kind of parted company with a lot of my colleagues, because that was never my style. I always was the voice of reason, so to speak. I have a favorite story from the Michael Jackson case. Every day when we would come in to the courthouse, those of us who had seats in the courtroom were brought in by deputies. And there was a chain link fence, and behind that were all the fans who had come for Michael, and they had their placards, and they would have a chant every day, which was, "Michael's innocent, Michael's innocent, the press are liars, press are liars." And I would look at them, and I would wave at them happily, and we would go in. Well, one morning I came and arrived, and there were three little girls waiting with their placards, and they called out to me, "Miss Deutsch, we need to talk to you." And I thought, "Oh my God, what did I do?" And so I went up to them and I said, "Hi." And they said, "We just want you to know that when we say the press are liars, we don't mean you."
Oh, that's sweet.
We read you on the internet every day, and mm-hmm. we know that you're unbiased.
That's terrific. Yeah. Linda, how has technology changed trial work over the years that you've been covering legal issues?
Technology has changed everything dramatically. When I started, I was working on a typewriter. with glue pots for, you know, the copy, and I was using pay phones. Always had to have a dime and or a quarter later. And, you know, now it's computers and it's cell phones. We didn't have cell phones. Mm-hmm. In the Patty Hearst case, I didn't have a cell phone. We went from having no communication to an overload, basically. In a case like O.J. where it was televised, my office was able to get the verdict off the TV mm-hmm. and move it out immediately, so I didn't have to fight my way out of the courtroom and get to a phone, as I did in other trials. Mm-hmm. And then later, reporters started bringing laptops into the courtroom, which I hated because I couldn't listen and hear this tap, tap, tapping next to me. So I would always sit far away from them. I always took notes. Mm-hmm. And I had varicolored pens. And I would underline things because I would be running right to a phone dictating mm-hmm. my story. Dictating it verbatim, it would be able to go on the wire with punctuation, capitalization, paragraphs, all of that. And I then would go to my notes and I would read a quote and continue the story. It was something that was unique to me. And people who took my dictation always remembered it. Mm-hmm. I guess because I made them type so fast.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, dictation in journalism certainly is a lost art.
It is.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It is.
And how many notebooks did you acquire over the years? How many filled notebooks from your legal work?
Well, I sent 65 boxes of materials to the AP archives at the end of my career. Mm-hmm. And about at least half of those were notebooks. Mm-hmm. I kept everything.
Breaking barriers. What kinds of barriers did you personally face during your career?
I don't think I faced huge barriers. I never went into it with the attitude that I was in any way different from anybody covering news, any of the guys. There were rules at the AP when I came there that affected me. Women, first of all, were never paid as much as men, mm-hmm. so I was definitely behind the eight ball on compensation. Certain stories they would not send women out on. For instance, the night that Bobby Kennedy was shot, I could not go to the hospital because they didn't send women out at night. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And there was when I first came to the AP, I was known as a newsman because that was the designation. And there was a lawsuit by the women of the AP for discrimination. Mm-hmm. And that was settled with a federal, what did they call it?
Not a federal ruling, but an EEOC. I know what you're talking about. Decision, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was an EEOC mm-hmm. Edict, mm-hmm. and that found that there had been discrimination. For one thing, women at that time were required to retire when they were 55. Mm-hmm. Men at 65. Mm-hmm. That went by the wayside. Women were. In the little things, women were now referred to as newswomen. Mm-hmm. Salaries were required to be equal, and we got money. There was a settlement so that every woman in the AP got an amount of money, supposedly, you know, making up for the difference. It didn't really, but at least you got some money. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I kind of came at a transitional time in journalism before me. Before my era, women were assumed to cover social pages, weddings. I did some of that at the very beginning when I was a kid, just because they needed somebody to write the stuff. Mm-hmm. But I was never that kind of a reporter, and I wasn't forced to be. I originally was going to be an entertainment writer. That's what I was interested in, was culture. Mm-hmm. And I did some of that. I reviewed movies. I reviewed concerts. I interviewed movie stars, covered the Oscars. Mm-hmm. But once I got into trials and got into the Manson trial, I realized, gosh, that was much more dramatic than anything I would ever see on the screen or on a TV. And I became hooked on that. Mm-hmm. As far as, you know, being discriminated against as a woman, you know, all I can say is that I suppose we had to prove ourselves a little more. But I personally had a wonderful time. Mm-hmm. And I can't say that I was denied access to any stories. Mm-hmm. I was sent to Guam to cover the evacuation of Vietnam for 6 weeks. I was sent around to do trials everywhere. I mean, mm-hmm. I went to Alaska to cover the Exxon Valdez trial. I went to Florida to cover the Kennedy Smith trial, to Arizona when the governor was impeached. Mm-hmm. I was their girl everywhere. Mm-hmm. And I think that there were a lot fewer of us. When I came to the AP in Los Angeles, I was the only woman. Mm-hmm. Replacing the only woman who was leaving to have a baby and was not going to come back. In those days, you didn't go and take leave and come back. It was a different time. But I was inspired by a number of older women, women older than me, who had achieved in this man's world. Theo Wilson was primary among them. She was a star in New York long before I was. I mean, I read her when I was in school. Mm-hmm. Fran Lewin of the AP had covered presidents beginning with Eisenhower. And at first they told her she had to cover only the women's side. She was going to cover the first lady. And eventually she wound up covering the presidents. Helen Thomas had a similar experience. Mm-hmm. And they were all friends of mine. They became friends of mine. Mm-hmm. And they were just invaluable in pushing me into the center of everything.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And tell us about the book that you're writing.
I'm writing a book which will be a memoir of my life and the trials I covered. And I've just started writing. It's been a whirlwind since I retired in February. I have been, you know, just so fortunate to be receiving many awards, including next week I will be getting the International Women's Media Foundation Lifetime Achievement Award, which to me is just incredible. It is going to be presented along with the Courage Awards, which are given to women who risk their lives to cover the news overseas. Mm-hmm. I never risked my life really much, except maybe inciting the ire of a judge or a lawyer. Maybe when I was searching for Patty Hearst, it was a little dangerous, but I've never encountered the danger these women have. Mm-hmm. So I am so honored to be getting this award. And I've been honored by a lot of people recently. Loyola Law School gave me an award that they usually give to lawyers and judges. Mm-hmm. And they said, oh, you could try a case. And so I've been running around doing that. I've been doing some TV, and now I'm concentrating on the book because I feel that I have to provide documentation of this incredible career I've had. And I have so many people to thank for it. I mean, you know, nobody does this work in this business alone. It's, you know, as they say, it takes a village. Mm-hmm. I've had so many colleagues that have helped me, that have taken my dictation, edited my copy, the editors who assigned me to these stories. I was sent down the best stories. And I think that the profession itself has been the best decision I ever made, was to become a journalist. I could have been an English professor. I could have been a poet, which is what I originally wanted. I don't think I would have made as much of a mark because in the end, I became a social historian. If you look at the cases I did, each one reflected. It was like a microcosm of what was going on in the world. The Manson trial was the 60s. The Sirhan trial was the age of assassinations. The Ellsberg trial, the Pentagon Papers trial, happened while the Vietnam War was still underway. Patty Hearst was a symbol of post-Vietnam alienation. And O.J. Simpson, of course, brought up so many issues, from domestic violence to the power of celebrity to racial issues. All of them had a theme, and I didn't realize that at the start. You know, you're in the thick of things. You don't think, oh boy, I'm reflecting on history. But after a while, I started looking at the pattern, and I realized I had been documenting the trials that reflected the culture of our times.
Well, it was an incredible career indeed, Linda. So thank you for joining us today from the Evelyn Y. Davis Studios at the National Press Foundation, where we make good journalists better. Today we've heard from Linda Deutsch, ace legal reporter for the Associated Press, in a masterclass interview.